The world loves an underdog, and for a lot of its history, Portugal has stood as one of Europe's greatest underdog stories. In this video, we take a look at the little-known Battle of Macau, which took place in 1622 between the Kingdom of Portugal and the Dutch Republic, an event where David defeats Goliath. In the late 1500s and early 1600s, the majority of Europe's powers were envious of Portugal's trade relations with China and Japan. These trade relations came out of Macau, a Portuguese settlement in southern coastal China. Portugal had only officially been authorized to settle permanently and legally trade in 1554 after signing the Luso-Chinese Agreement. In return for settling, the Portuguese agreed to pay taxes. This was a massive breakthrough, since negotiations between both countries had been ongoing for decades. The Ming Dynasty was, for a very long time, against allowing the Portuguese to settle and trade in the area because, well, they were very naughty towards the locals. Also, the Sultan of Malacca warned the Ming Emperor of the Portuguese, who had conquered Malacca earlier in 1511. So, all in all, they didn't have the best reputation. After the agreement was signed, Macau's fortunes flourished. Portuguese and Chinese merchants quickly flocked to the settlement, and for the next couple of years, Macau experienced a sort of golden age. The issue for Portugal, however, came in 1580, when the Portuguese crown fell under the Iberian Union with Spain. This meant that Spain's enemies were now also Portugal's enemies. The Spanish did do some good. They elevated Macau to city status and allowed trade relations between Macau and Spanish Manila to continue unaltered. Unfortunately, Macau's prosperity attracted European maritime powers that were looking to expand their own empires. The most significant of these being the Dutch Republic. The Dutch were frustrated that their merchants in Harada, Japan could not compete with Portuguese merchants in Nagasaki due to their easy access to China. Conquering Macau would have been massively beneficial, since it would grant them a base in China and also reduce Spanish influence in the region. As a result, the Dutch mounted raids on Macau in 1601, 1603, and 1607. However, it was only in 1622 that the Republic decided to plan a full invasion of the city. We should highlight that Macau's defenses were very, very limited. The Chinese government forbade the Portuguese from building extensive defenses so that they wouldn't have a stronghold within Chinese territory. Therefore, Macau was only defended by a small number of batteries. The state of the city's defenses was made known to the Dutch in 1621 when they captured a Portuguese ship on its way to Malaya. With this information, the governor of the Dutch East Indies, Jan Pierson Cohen, believed that Macau could not stand off a serious attack. Cohen put together a fleet of 8 ships and ordered that any Dutch ship found along the way had to join the operation. When it arrived in Macau, the fleet, which was led by Cornelius Geyersen, was composed of 13 ships totaling 1,300 men and a landing force of around 800 soldiers. The extra ships consisted of Dutch vessels and Japanese mercenaries that had been picked up along the way. By comparison, Little Macau was defended by some 50 musketeers and 100 residents able to bear arms. On the 22nd of June, 1622, Geyersen sent a scouting party onshore to identify entry points and determine whether the local Japanese population would remain neutral during the attack. To their delight, the Dutch found that the majority of Chinese residents had fled the city to avoid the oncoming battle. To add to Portugal's misery, most of Macau's residents were in Guangzhou buying goods, whilst most soldiers had been sent to fight for the Ming Emperor against the Manchu conquest of China. The Dutch took the opportunity to bombard the city with cannon fire and spent the night celebrating their sure win. Although only numbering 150, the Portuguese also made sure to hold celebrations of their own and show their bravery in the face of their enemy. The Portuguese commander, Lopo Sarmento de Carvalho, was certain that the Dutch would launch their invasion the following day, so he spent the little time he had preparing for an imminent attack. On the 24th of June 1622, during the Feast of St. John the Baptist, the Dutch ships opened fire on the city. The Portuguese responded with fire from the batteries, which saw heavy damage inflicted on the Dutch ship Galias. Whilst the city was bombarded in the east, a landing party of 800 Dutch soldiers made their way to shore via the south. Here, the Dutch used one of the first recorded cases of smokescreen to aid their attack by firing a barrel of damp gunpowder into the wind. A small contingency of Portuguese soldiers defended the beach, reportedly killing 40 whilst firing into the smoke and injuring Admiral Geyersen. Command of the Dutch was then taken by Captain Hans Ruffin, who successfully pushed the Portuguese back into the city. 600 Dutch pursued, fighting the retreating Portuguese in the process until they came within firing range of the Mont Fortress. Stationed there was an Italian priest called Giacombo Ro, who managed to fire a cannon shot that hit a keg of gunpowder, killing many Dutch in the process. And who knows, maybe the Dutch soldiers were shouting, "It's coming home," which would have upset the Italian priest very, very much. Fatigued and low on ammunition, the majority of which was lost in the explosion, the Dutch looked to retreat and regather at the beach. However, the Portuguese soon realized that the bombardment of the east was simply a decoy and that the majority of Dutch soldiers were with the landing party to the south. The Portuguese gathered their forces made up of musketeers, black slaves, Macanese locals and priests and prepared a counterattack. Commander Lopo de Sarmento de Carvalho signaled the attack, and with the battle cry Santiago, or St. James in English, the Portuguese forces chased the Dutch with great ferocity and bravery, chopping the heads off retreating soldiers in the name of John the Baptist. The Dutch fled on their launch boats, many of which overturned, causing even more deaths, whilst some did make it back to their main boats. The following day, Admiral Geyersen sent a truce to the Portuguese, signalling the successful defence of Macau. Official figures cite that the Portuguese killed between 300 and 600 Dutch soldiers that day, including 7 captains and 4 lieutenants. The governor of Dutch East India, Jan Pierson Cohen, attributed the loss to the bravery and fighting abilities of the black slaves in Macau, stating that there were little Portuguese to be seen in the battlefield. To be fair, the Portuguese themselves were very thankful to their help, freeing many slaves that had fought in the battle. Later, the Portuguese established a permanent governor in Macau and started building proper defences. The country would continue to profit from the China-Japan trade, which would come to an end when the Japanese expelled all Portuguese in 1639. The battle was celebrated each year in Macau on the 24th of June until the handover of the city to China in 1999.
Thank you so much for listening and for watching. Please feel free to subscribe. Feel free to get in touch, drop your ideas, your opinions with me. Follow me on Instagram. I'm always happy to chat on there, and all the best.